Joe Castaway Coolis. If you're from Cleveland, Ohio, you probably recognize his name. If you follow hunting and fishing trophy records, you've probably read his name. This film is not about the records books. It's about a very young man who always took a leap of faith to achieve his goals. I walked into his studio too many years ago than I want to own. I stepped into a world I never knew existed. I knew nothing of taxidermy, hunting, conservation, growing a business, or much else. I was just a teenager looking for an after-school job. I watched this man have so many extraordinary adventures, achieve unfathomable goals, but mostly he did what he loved. He did not work his whole life to retire so he may then have the freedom to fulfill his dreams. He just lived his life doing what he loved. Did you know this was what you were going to do?
Yes, I did, in a way. When I was young, my uncle Lottie took me to see a film that was put at a school by Wally Tabor. Wally Tabor used to travel around the world, film hunting trips, and then go to a school and would show them, usually two different films. And I saw that, two different years. And I thought, God, I can do that. And so I'll never forget that I thought, I could do the same thing that he did, and which I actually did later. I rented the school, Chanel High School, let me use their auditorium. And two different years, I put on films where I travel all over the world.
How did you get interested in taxidermy?
Again, from Uncle Lott Hayek, who took me to see the films. Well, he said, I'll pay for this correspondence course. He said, you need to be a taxidermist. There aren't any, and all they do is travel, and they're always hunting, but you don't have any competition. So I took the Northwest School of Taxidermy, which so many people have taken, they just quit. And luckily I did. I did this in March of 1959 is when I got the diploma. But it got me my start in taxidermy. I opened a shop right after I graduated from college. I spent 4 years in architecture, decided I don't want to be an architect. In fact, I got a degree in cinematography, and that's when I traveled around the world and did the same thing as Wally Tabor did. I would get a school and I would show the films. But so when I graduated from college, a store opened up and I worked out of my basement for years. I thought I needed to do this in a regular studio. I opened up Bedford Taxidermy the day after I graduated from college, and that was almost 50 years later, and today I've got this going.
Okay, so you're promoting your business, and there's no internet, no Facebook, nothing. What did you do to promote your business and get the attention of other hunters?
It actually started with the Cleveland Sportsman Show. In 1962, I got a little 10x10 booth, and it was a way to meet hunters and fishermen and show my work off. And actually, I landed up doing that same show for 45 straight years, and the booths got bigger and bigger. But it started with that little booth, and I met somebody there, in fact. That's how the hunting started, the big game hunting. I met somebody from Indian Archery, and they said, we'll teach you how to shoot a bow. And I thought, good, I'll go shoot a brown bear. And that's really, they taught me how to shoot, and I got the bow, and I went to Alaska, and I shot a Kodiak. So that's how we started bow hunting, with the brown bear. But that sports show, that was the key, actually, the one thing that really propelled me into the hunting world. Because maybe a couple years later, I ran into Richard White at the Sportsman Show. And he was from Africa. And we started about talking about Africa. He says, why don't you come to Africa? I said, oh man, that's a dream, go to Africa. So he says, I'm going to go hunting in about 3 or 4 weeks. Why don't you come? Oh, yeah, sure. No passport, no nothing. So, okay, I'm going to do this. So I contacted airlines. I got the tickets. I had to go to New York to get the passport en route. I had no passport. I went to New York in the morning, waited all day, got my passport, and now I'm in Africa, and he meets me. And we go into the bush, and we hunted on these government lands, and it was kind of a neat thing back then because you just went. But these government lands were like parks that you could go and hunt for 2 weeks, and you bought an inexpensive license. You had to have all your own gear, and he had all his camping gear and the like. And you hired people, guides that were there. You had no GPS. You had no maps. You just went. But that's what Africa was like in the beginning. You just went. And you didn't know where you were going to go or what you were going to see, but that's what made it a true adventure. I always had in the back of my mind, I wanted to be charged by Cape Buff. I thought that was the ultimate thrill. And actually, it happened on that trip. And that's a long story, and we won't get into it. But I did get the Cape Buffalo, but I got all these other animals. And now I took pictures and I studied them, so now I know how to mount that animal. So now I could actually come back to the States and get somebody to bring me an African collection, and I'll know what it would look like. So I studied all that. And so that propelled me, because the hunting world is basically, back then, was only for the elite. And it was exciting, but it was expensive. But I figured ways to do it. I either made films for hunting companies or for a hunter, or I would work or I would guide or would do whatever I could do to be able to go, because I couldn't afford to go. All these big game hunters shoot all these animals, they have money. But if I do with a bow, maybe now I could get noticed. And that would help propel the taxidermy business. But it's only because somebody from Indian Archery, that was actually how I got my Kodiak brown bear, they said, okay, if you go and do it and make a film and you accomplish it, we'll pay for the license. So, oh, sure, I could just go do that. Well, I did. But I did have that drive to do it and didn't realize how big of a gamble it was going to be. But I accomplished it, but because I had the drive, you got to have a drive to want to accomplish something, and no matter what gets you in your way, you got to find a way around it. Because if you run up against the first roadblock and quit, your whole life will be that way, and you'll say, I wish I would have done that. No, you got to drive and do it. And that's how I got to do that. Just got to experience Africa back then, how it was truly wild and just a fantastic place to be. Today it's a lot different, but I got to do it right place, the right time.
So you made the front cover?
Yeah, that was Indian Archery made me this 100-pound bow because I'm going to go shoot a rhino. I need something big. So they made me a 100-pound bow. And it came 2 weeks before I'm leaving for Africa. And, of course, it's like pulling a 2x4. And so I would pick it up every half hour, try to pull it. Couldn't pull it, but I kept, as I was working here at the shop, I'd go by every half hour and try to pull it. And eventually I could almost do that. After a solid week, I could actually pull it back. I'm still not shooting it. Then I went in the alleyway here, and I marked off 30 yards, and I would shoot 3 arrows, because that's, first it was 1 arrow, and I would do that once every hour. Go out, shoot 1 arrow, just shoot and shoot it. And within 2 weeks, I could actually show that I could shoot the bow and hit something. But the neat thing about it, out of the hundreds and hundreds of people that tried to pull it, because everybody wanted to try this bow, there were only 2 people in the world that ever pulled it besides me. One was a construction person that happened to have the right muscles. A lot of people got really close, and if they would have just bit it a little bit more, they would have did it. But they didn't, and they quit. But I had this little, I met a bushman in Africa. He was in the Kalahari Desert, a Kalahari Bushman. And he was the only guy, other person than me, that could pull it. He was like not even 5 foot, probably weighed about 100 pounds. But he was one of the guys that, in fact, he gave me this arrow as a gift. But they use this to take big game, but they would use poison on here. This, you'd see where, you know, they would bake some kind of a poison on. But he gave me that as a gift, and he made this machete, which is, he made this as well. But he gave me these again, but it was so cool. We had a competition, and he and I would shoot. We took a piece of a wildebeest, and we would swing it, and it is dead tired. We would swing it, and I'd use my 100-pound bow, and he would use his bow, he would use mine. But he was the only person that could do it. So Indian Archery said, okay, and they put me on the cover with the rhino after I did it. So they made me the bow, they made me special arrows, but they believed that I could do it, and I believed I could do it, and I did.
So what was the licensure to hunt the rhino in the early 70s?
It was actually the first white rhino permit that was allowed, and it was $3,000. Today, where you can hunt white rhino, it is up to $60,000. So it's a huge difference. So again, right place, right time.
Wow. And so you took the big five.
Right. The leopard, the lion, the Cape buffalo, the elephant, and the white rhino. Later on, I got the black rhino as well. So I've got the big five with the bow. And again, as I said, right place, right time. Today, it's almost impossible to do those kinds of things.
And you were 29
yep.
when you went. Wow.
Yep. Lucky.
Joe Castaway Coolis is not just the person. He became a brand, an inspiration. As a young man, he found a way to do what he loved, to support his way of life. Just think for a moment, why in the world would a bow company sponsor a young man to hunt the big five? If you met Joe, you would know. He was just gonna do it. He has many accomplishments. The outdoor world of Castaway Coolis TV show, a grand slam of sheep, and a showroom filled with trophies from his worldwide adventures, which have inspired many young boys who became his clients. So tell me the real story of how you became known as Castaway.
Well, tell you what, that's a story for another show.